Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you, kind sir, Ambassador Ong King Yong, S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies, and the Singapore Government, and Parks, the media, ladies and gentlemen, for giving me and my colleagues the honor of presenting this speech this afternoon. And many thanks to our old friend, Joseph Koh, who is here with Mrs. Koh, for making things happen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I recall a recent CNN documentary hosted by Dr. Sanjay Gupta on intelligent nations, and in that program, he ranked Singapore as the world's most intelligent nation. On the basis of his arguments, I believe him, and today's invitation is therefore a privileged occasion for me, the government of Sabah, and my team. Thank you. Now my story on Sabah. For that, of course, I need my spectacles, but I will not need my testicles. And how to plunder natural resources, the Sabah story of the past. As a nation state established in 1881, run by a company with a royal charter, the British North Borneo Chartered Company, the company government, it would appear, had a dual purpose. First, to make money for its shareholders, and secondly, to do good to the native population, my ancestors. Naturally, financial returns came first. North Borneo was therefore opened up to the world for investments, primarily for agriculture, including rubber, coconuts, and so on. The early rubber booms of the 20th century helped somewhat, but the company government still could not make ends meet. It was only after timber was discovered as a viable alternative for exports did the company start to generate sizable income, in any case, barely. It was company policy to maximize returns despite the environmental effects. Riparian reserves were logged, planes stripped of valuable timber, etc. As far as taxes were concerned, leakages were high, and any intervention by the civilian government was met with disdain. A company official, William Cowie, who happened to be a gun runner for the Sulu Sultanate in those days, sacked the governor for making certain comments about the things that were going on in the ground. Now, after he left, the government was only able to establish the Forestry Department in 1914 in order to regulate timber harvesting and tax collection. Now, concessions were offered internationally that culminated with the sole award to one monopoly company called the British Borneo Timber Company Limited, established in London in 1920, that was given all, I repeat, all of the timber resources of Sabah for a period of 100 years. The monopoly was so pervasive that even if you have timber in your own backyard, on your own land with a title, you still have to pay a tribute to the monopoly. This was rent-seeking at its highest. Given that the civilian government company was so dependent on this one monopoly, the concessionaire virtually became a government on its own. They dictated policies and not the government. At the height of its arrogance, you won't believe this, but these are facts, they stopped the creation of forest reserves, which would have meant rules and regulations. Timber was felled indiscriminately, anywhere, everywhere. They created waste in the jungle, but they exempted themselves from penalties for abandoning logs. The Forestry Department had no teeth. Exports measurements were declared as the monopoly deemed fit. You are not allowed to check and verify. The company did not allow royalties to be increased. Now, with the coming and ending of the Second World War, the chartered company could no longer manage North Borneo, was virtually bankrupt, and thereafter relinquished its rights to the Crown, and Sabah became a colony in 1946. The colonial government then negotiated the end of the monopoly, which was a protracted process, ending only in 1952 after a hefty payment of £1 million sterling. That was $8 million stretch dollars in those days. And they were paid guaranteed profits and the right of the monopoly to choose the best forest of Sabah as its rump concession for another 100 years. And you know how much they were given? 1,000 square miles of the best forest as compensation to sweeten the deal. Now, I thought, Ambassador Ong, that abuse was a particular Asian trait. I thought it was in our genes only. Now, with the end of the monopoly, forest reserves were expanded and new concessions issued, including to local taukes. Production of timber started to increase after that. Then, for reasons still blur, the British government suddenly decided to give independence to the Borneo states and to move out quickly by the early 1960s. For the record, there was no real serious movement for independence at that time. Singapore there was, but not in the Borneo states. Now, for independence to come about, political parties had to be created and its leaders chosen amongst community leaders and the financing thereof. And when these community leaders inquired about the concept of political parties, particularly its financing and management, the colonial government instead granted timber concessions to them, which they call special licenses. I suppose the governor said, "Don't worry, old chap, I know what to do." Now, knowing full well that the early native leaders had little experience or knowledge on running concessions, the role of the taukes of Sabah was but a fait accompli. Thus was born the political party tauke government troika in the exploitation of the timber resources. And when independence came in 1963, she's all yours, old chap, the troika was expanded to a level probably not known in the tropical world then and until today. Sabah became the largest exporter of tropical timber in the world in 1979, and the revenue reached about 1.1 billion. And that's about 70% of the total revenue. And today it's only 3%. Timber became the oxygen for development, political financing, political patronage, rewards for supporters, etc. And in one visit to Dramaquid Forest Reserve in 1997, the Prime Minister then, to Dr. Badr Muhammad, had this impression of us.
"We used to be very happy with bags of money.
No bags of money, unfortunately, nowadays. Now, political instability over a good 30 years exacerbated the scenery, with massive logging licenses rising before, during, and after elections. This I call the Pink Panther graph, and I will elaborate on it later. You know these peaks, this is before, during, and after elections. That's when you give out short-term licenses. But now that we have political stability, it's no longer there, or hardly there. Now, how to plunder forests a second time? This is very interesting. Sometimes good intentions can lead to disastrous outcomes from an environmental point of view. You know, I'm not anti-British, but the British, they're fond of us, and they came back again in the 1960s, and this time to do a land utilization study for Sabah. Their recommendations included setting aside the best lands for agriculture and the worst lands for forestry and conservation. Good lands mean lowlands, highest biodiversity, and where the iconic species are, rhinos, pygmy elephants, orangutans, and so on. And at the conclusion of this study, and we adopted their recommendations 100%, and we took out 1 million hectares of lowland forest reserves, which are the richest areas as far as biodiversity is concerned, which happens to be orangutan country, all these pink maps. And how could Sabah argue with the wisdom of its former colonial masters? At that time, orangutan was not an issue. Values were different. We needed to diversify anyway from being solely dependent on timber. We only had a handful of experts on agriculture and on the environment. But this zoning on the best economic use concept is not unique. You have worse examples in other countries. No New Zealanders here. New Zealand is one of them. They only had about 23% native forest left after 100 years of occupation, and the forest lands have now been relegated to residual usage, the lowest denominator. I'm not anti-British, like what I've said. In fact, my mother was an Anglophile, and tried to persuade my late father to migrate to Britain. And my father's answer in Malay was, Kamu saya cuci parit London kah? Kau pergi sendirilah. You want me to clean the streets and drains of London? You go yourself. I'm not going there. So there you go. Your statutory duty. Do you acquiesce or do you do something? What can Forestry Department do given the apparent systemic breakdown in governance? It is my opinion that the department must first prove that there is an alternative to plunder that addresses the requirements of sustainability. To be convincing, three matters must be addressed: ethos, pathos, and logos. And in translation, these are the ethical appeal and to convince, the emotions of the goal involved, and the logic of it all. Bottom line, do you believe me? Do you have credibility? My predecessor, Datuk Mila Munang, despite the chaos, launched a project called Dramacut Forest Reserve Sustainable Forest Management Project with German assistance in a 55,000 hectare log over rainforest in 1989, despite the chaos. The idea was to convince policymakers that there is an alternative that will address sustainability, the social part, environmental part, and the economic part. For that, you must prove your competence in the light of bad or worsening public perception. Starting in 89, which I had the privilege of being part of the team, the forest area was finally certified as well managed under the gold standard of the FSC, Forest Stewardship Council. And this was the first tropical rainforest in the world to be certified as such. And in order to reap maximum policy benefits from the outcome, Mahathir was there. And this is his opinion.
As far as I'm concerned, this is a fantastic experiment. Unless you try it on a large scale, you can't win. So please take time. No, we are serious about this thing. I'd like to congratulate you on what we have done. That was a very good and very, very emotional presentation. And I hope that emotion will help.
In other words, he's saying, make sure it's not just hot air. Move on. Now, with that political endorsement at the highest level, we expanded this concept to cover other areas in Sabah. Through the launching of the SFM system for long-term forest management, 100 years, but this time involving the private sector. The idea was to replicate the Dramacut model, but this time with private money and enterprise. 10 organizations were chosen, but we knew full well from the beginning that some had a hidden agenda. True enough, those who could not deliver and tried to change the rules were eliminated through terminations. Nonetheless, this long-term approach has helped to phase out short-term licenses that had created much harm. But it has not been smooth sailing. The rotation system of leadership in Sabah, which was a two-year thing, brought in its complications in that policies tried to be altered or watered down and the concept of FMU question. But with the abolition of the musical chair system, it is no longer looking back. The FMU program is just one reform agenda. However, it is not enough. Other matters must come in for long-term success. Now, what are they? What else can we do? How to reinforce this momentum? First, you must save the best to posterity, the untouchables. From a paltry 120,000 hectares of forest reserves in the 1950s, because we were not allowed to expand by a company, this has now risen to 3.6 million hectares, or 49% of Sabah, another 4% under parks. That means 53%. At the national level, they say 50%. You must have at least 50% under forest. We have gone one step further than this. IUCN says that you must protect 10% minimum of your ecosystems. We have 22% under TPAs, which is rising up to 30% or 2.2 million hectares by government policy by the year 2025. And we are making good progress on this. More or less every year we have additional 200,000 hectares for this purpose. Why? Ronald Reagan said that, not me. Now, since 2009, all our forest licenses are independently audited by an internationally acclaimed auditor to ensure compliance and good governance. This costs the Sabah government US dollars $1 million a year, but it's worth every cent. And with EU assistance, we have now expanded to include TILAS, Timber Licensing Assurance System. This is the pillar of good governance, whereby branding is important. That means anything that comes from Sabah, any timber, is legal. Third-party auditing was not imposed on us, but was entirely our own initiative. I'm too proud to be pushed around by people and say, you should do this and that. No. This is our place. We know what to do. We're not going to be stupid and drown ourselves in the process. Engaging with the world, having lots of friends and lovers. We don't have a monopoly of good ideas and resources. Therefore, we engage with everybody. Queens, kings, Singapore, Germany, Netherlands, you name it. And you need to publicize, you need to document what you do and what you have achieved. From time to time, you have to blow your own trumpet because nobody else is going to do it for you. Security of tenure, the only state in the whole of Malaysia whereby there is no executive power to play around with land policies is Sabah. If there are going to be any changes, it must go to the Assembly. If it goes to the Assembly, it becomes public knowledge. Then it's debated. Then you can't hide your intentions. It's out there in the open. Getting things right the first time, reduce impact logging in the tropics. I'm proud to say again that we pioneered this. Since 2010, when it comes to natural forest management areas, this is all under reduced impact logging. The thing is, the damage itself will cost you a lot of money to restore the forest. But with reduced impact logging, this does not happen, and you can do sustainable logging every 25 years. Otherwise, society has to pay for the damage while the logger migrates to Timbuktu and become respectable people. Now, getting politically certified, this is vital. A step-by-step approach is vital. A policy that results in political demise will not be accepted. Compromises must be made on the basis of 5 steps forward and 2 steps backwards. That means I take 5, you take 2. To me, it is a plus. But do not try to pull a fast one on your boss. The good, the bad, and the ugly must be spelled out, honestly. In the end, your story, if credible, will be accepted, unless you have to deal with bloody-minded rogues as in the past. And in this day and age, convinced that conservation is good politics, but never outshine your boss. Independent forest certification under a world-recognized system. I've mentioned this. We have about 1 million hectares now. We're moving forward, but you must benchmark against the best. For example, Changi Airport, not second-class certification. Law reforms, any lawyers here? This is a continuous process that we have to keep up with the times and the opportunities. But be prepared to have long and protracted arguments with legal minds that are closed or people who have biblical lifetimes, grandsons of Prophet Abraham. Time and a sense of urgency mean nothing to some people. So maybe Shakespeare was right. Find the lawyers and hang them. Now, meritocracy and continuous human resource improvement. When first appointed as director, the Chief Minister, Datuk Sri Panglima Musa Haji Aman, called me over, told me in no uncertain terms, meritocracy must prevail in your department. Pure and simple, he said. Do not surround yourself with idiots. That's what he said too. Now, I don't intend to suffer fools, and so I surround myself with people who are smarter than me. This has done the department the world of good, and me too, and the smart people are here with me today. Kiasu, Singapore, they say, is kiasu. Well, I'm also kiasu. Do not be satisfied with one success. So expand. Improve on your standards. Improve on your performance. There must be a critical mass of successful units that you manage. At the same time, the department can only set standards if it practices what it preaches. So preach hands-on. Sometimes I talk about this PWD. Everything is now outsourced. So do you know how to build a road yourself? You don't know. So how can you tell people to set standards when you don't even know how to start a bulldozer, for example? So we do everything ourselves in our own area. Then we set standards. One size does not fit all. We've got to be flexible in assessing approaches for successful forest management. It is the end result that matters. What did Deng Xiaoping say? Black cat, or yellow cat, or white cat, so long it catches mice. The example is mosaic system, tree growing where we blend industrial tree plantations with natural forest management. And it works out very nicely. And do not forget your core business, which is forest restoration. Since you've done the damage, you got to fix it. And now we are turning the tide. Our forests that are being restored are increasing every year. And the threats and opportunities. Money. She wants to forget about the price tag, but I can't because I live in the real world. You ever heard of IRR, internal rate of return? The economists here, present net worth, benefit cost ratios. This is the essence of forest economics. This is what they drum into your head, forestry school. Go for short rotations. Liquidate everything now. Discount what you're going to get from the future because you've got to do your economics. It's not going to work out. Now, how can forestry win in a situation like that? When you follow this concept, which was used, I was told, by some engineers in the United States after the war to justify building bridges. So we are equated with building bridges. No, it doesn't work like that. If anything, it says, plunder now to boost IRR. Liquidate. That is the message. But to be realistic, one must come up with an option that can address both economics and natural values at the same time. The biggest threat, my opinion, to the existence of rainforest is its low intrinsic value. It has such a low value. You can say, oh, I love it. I love this rainforest, but I want your money too, not just your love. Both will do. Prices have not gone up really over the past 30 years on purchasing power basis, and in terms of return per hectare to the Sabah government, from its 4 million hectares of rainforest is only 35 ringgit per hectare per year. And what does oil palm give the government of Sabah? 1,000 ringgit per hectare per year in direct revenue, 30 times more. Now, in a developing economy, is such a disparity sustainable? So how do you become pragmatic? How do you address the forest revenue famine in the next 20 years? You've got to be a devil. So we've taken 200,000 hectares of gross forest lands under our holdings to allow oil palm to be established. I argued with the government, this will tie us down for the next 20 years while we wait for the forest to produce big volumes of timber again. And this so far is doing quite well. It should be able to pay for the department's running about 150 million a year, my lifestyle, and all that. And what will we do? This is the first time I'm announcing this publicly. On Wednesday, the Cabinet of Sabah decided that there should be jurisdictional certification for the whole state of Sabah as far as oil palm is concerned with the RSPO standard. For the next 10 years, we will work with the assistance of NGOs, big companies, and so on, and the RSPO, to ensure that everything that is oil palm in Sabah will be certified. We can't compete on the basis of size, which is too small, but we must have something extra. So we compete on the basis of governance. Some people may say, you're a busybody. What's oil palm got to do with forestry? Never mind, I'm a busybody. Because that's our survival there. Now, purists, especially certification bodies, To me, they do more harm than good. They want to be so pure. That means you can't convert some of your forest into tree plantations, for example, timber tree plantations after 1994. You can destroy everything before 1994. And you allowed only 5% of conversion. And those who destroyed long ago can be certified. And those who need space now for short economic rotations of tree plantations, they are forbidden from joining the club. But how can you have credibility if you're not certified? And if certification becomes an elitist approach, not even allowing flexibility in the interest of economic viability, how can there be sustainable forest management if you don't address economics? I said as much in Bonn, the headquarters of FSC. I received the support of the majority, maybe 90%. But there was this 10% called Greenpeace, the only two people. They decided for the rest. Because it's got to be unanimous, we could not get our way. So I tell them, by rejecting us, you're not influencing events, you're not influencing practices on the ground. You want us to go to hell when you should be taking us to heaven. Well, let's see what happens next. Carbon forestry and REDD. This is important now with the haze you see out there. They say this REDD will solve the problem of deforestation. But what happens actually is only those who are bad performers are being rewarded. Because in the case of Sabah, most places in Sabah, you can't have this REDD money because there is no additionality. I asked them, what is additionality? They say it is the additionality of fear, the additionality of bad practices, the additionality of chaos like you see out there, and plunder in the project area, and the additionality of forest fires. Now, if a project is well managed, certified, the carbon has no value. But if you have all these threats, it will be beautiful. Everybody wants it. So I talk as much to the Norwegian ambassador to Malaysia. He comes to our HOB events. And I asked him once, you're giving $2 billion to so-and-so. He said, yes. I want some of it. He said, I'll think about it. So he's coming again next week. And I say to him, you sit with me. Your $2 billion has gone up in smoke. What are you going to do about it? I told Prince Charles as much in London. I told him, sir, this REDD business is a concept introduced by the grandchildren of Al Capone. He just laughed. Let's see what happens. Payment for environmental services. Forests supply this. Clean water, so important here in Singapore, in fact, elsewhere. Unpolluted air, like we see out there. How much chaos that has caused us, this pollution. If you don't keep your air clean, and where does the clean air come from the forest? We're making a lot more money now from water in Sabah. In fact, the water department earns more money than the forestry department. We're looking at other avenues for revenue generation while we wait for our forest to become mature again. Like geothermal power generation, tourism is big business, and things like that. The other threat, illegal felling. We were the illegal felling capital of the world in the tropics. That was in those days. But we have addressed this through reforms. Although it is no longer near the scale of what it was, it is still there. What frustrates us is the activities of lone wolves. Conventional logging you can take care of, illegal logging or whatever, you can see them. But lone wolves are very hard to detect. They go deep inside, convert timber into trees, timber into planks and so on, and take them out slowly over time. Transboundary issue, illegal immigrants coming in to do illegal felling, so on and so forth, that is also an issue. But we got to upscale our capacity. So now, instead of asking for help, for protection, we have guns. and to make sure that nothing gets away. Products like Gaharu, we use trend dogs. We have aerial surveillance, continuous operations, roadblocks, etc. I'll show you this clip. Technology. Yes. No? It's not working. Okay. Never mind. Encroachments. Commercial operators from time to time are involved. Illegal palm oil, so on and so forth. When it comes to conventional encroachments, we can handle that. Companies prosecute, fine, put them in jail. But when it comes to communities, how do we settle this? So I learned something today from Ambassador Ong regarding a proposed project that covers some forest areas, islands, that involve some community people. In the end, they have gone for a pragmatic solution where the developer will accommodate those communities who are found there instead of evicting them. Now, we should have thought about this in Sabah, and I think this is the best approach. Otherwise, you end up with starting small wars or big wars. Let's here see this war. It's not working? I think this is important for you to watch. What's that? All right. Anyway, while waiting for that, that must be a curse from the community, but never mind. The native Tauke's. It's Sabah government policy today to create native Tauke's in forest management who can provide specialized services in silviculture, tree planting, infrastructure development, so on. And the best of them, we reward. Okay, we go back. The curse is now no longer there. Okay, start. So you start from zero. We must see how the communities beat you up. People do all sorts of things. Okay, what I've shown you there is one operation we did, which we did not sort out properly. We did not plan properly. There was this particular community that has illegally settled on about 1,000 acres of oil palm. So my officer in the field decided to evict them. They went there with the police and so on and so forth. And in the end, my officer ended up being beaten up, and the police did not want to do anything because they said, what do you want us to do, shoot these people? I think that was a fair answer to that. And about the riparian reserve, no? Yeah, why not? Show it to them. They'll never see this again. So.
This is an example of an exercise in futility. This is a riparian reserve, which is supposed to be 20 or 50 meters from the river bank, which you have to keep intact. Unfortunately, the landowners who own that bit of land there decided that they had the right to just whack everything off, which is against the law. This will reduce the quality of water. It will make it muddy. It will also bring in poisons and residues later on, effluent, once this place is developed for whatever crop that is going to be established here. So we have come in, we have taken action, we're taking them to court. At the same time, through the help of NGOs and scientific community and the community itself, we have started to restore and rehabilitate. But this could have been prevented. The complication here is those people who are responsible for this are members of the community themselves. So it's not just a simple matter of enforcement, taking people to court. The part on publicity, on explaining and trying to convince them that there is a better way of developing land, it's vital. So, for the moment, we carry on regardless. Let the show begin! This is an example of an exercise in futility. This is
That did not stop them. We'll see what happens. Now, engage with the oil palm industry, vitally important. Out the front there is Sime Darby, which gave us quite a big endowment to restore rainforests. This is good for them, good for their reputation, good for the world, and good for orangutans. And of course, the efforts of the RSPO is also vital. Discipline. Discipline, or the lack of it, was a chronic disease in the department. The political instability did not help, and it exacerbated the situation. The political will to act was not there. No real effort was made to address the issue. The situation now is not perfect by any means, but at the very least, those who try if caught will be given due process. The consequences will be determined by the authorities. The warlords have left the department on their own free will, or resigned, or disappeared. However, they may be in hibernation, waiting to wake up at an appropriate time. Creativity, important to Singapore, important to the United States, also important to us. So we introduced the world's first tropical biobanking project at a forest reserve called Malwa, whereby we gave a value of $34 million to it, and we were supposed to sell these units for $10 per square meter. It is an economic and a commercial approach to conservation, which is unique outside the United States. However, nothing has been solved for all kinds of excuses. Maybe they don't like it because it's a commercial approach. They probably thought that conservation cannot be a commercial approach. But here we are, we're trying, we could continue with this. And it takes a long time to fix mistakes. For example, Ramakut took us 20 years to get our money back. And what commercial interest will wait 20 years just to break even? Therefore, bad practices lead to bad economics. Then, what are you going to do? Are you going to lead public opinion? There's no shame in this. Right or wrong, you just carry on. Make sure you are able to influence the public opinion on what you are doing. Show some balls, they say. Now, the what if question, very important. Say, oh, very good, we're doing this and that. Will this continue? What happens if a madman gets elected? The conquistadors. I got a lot of help from Joseph Kohl on this. Now, the plunder of the new world by the old world for gold, silver, diamonds, sex, timber, slaves, etc., and the gifts of the old world to the new world of syphilis, of smallpox, you name it, did not result in a happy, sustainable, and equitable society. On the contrary, the rich natural resources abused result in a poorer society. The tragedy of the commons, they say, was a tragedy grand scale. Similarly, this can happen to Sabah if the reform programs are not sustained and the conquistadors get voted in with populist promises or give away forest lands. That is the easiest thing to do. Now, in order to dampen or mitigate against such outcomes, in the event of political changes not in favor of conservation, the efforts taken today must be institutionalized. This means it is a successful story, successful. It is rated as world class. You don't want just Borneo class, you want world class. And independently verified, and the ownership is widespread, locally, nationally, internationally, that means Singapore included as the stakeholder. Now, with wide-scale participation, I pray even the descendants of Francisco Pizarro will think twice before reversing the conservation programs. There is safety in numbers, and politics is a numbers game, pure and simple. That is why our engagement with society at large is vital to our interests, this program today being just one example. And I said as much to His Royal Highness Prince William in 2012 when he came to Denham Valley, in that he asked whether the participation of the Royal Society in Sabah should be continued. I said, yes, sir, that strengthens the arm of conservation. Now, his visit sealed that status. Similarly, my successors should not go through wars that my team had to endure, but they must be street smart, get up quickly when they fall, and strategize in case of emergencies. So simulate some war scenarios, play war games. And always remember, I learned this from Singapore again, this phrase yesterday, motherhood statement. And what it is all about, the greatest good for the greatest number in the long run, and what are we trying to save? No curses this time, I hope. What are we trying to save? Apart from me, you better save me here, man.
The long and winding road.
Okay, the road is winding, you know. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience. Before I leave this stage, I would like to bring to your attention that despite Singapore's small size, it has arguably richer biodiversity than Western Europe. It certainly is richer on per unit area basis, would you believe it, than New Zealand. You may not know it, but Singapore directly or indirectly has contributed to help Sabah achieve good forest governance. For example, WWF gets some of its financing for forest restoration in a particular reserve from Singaporean interests. Similarly, the purchase of a tract of forest where a rhino was caught for captive breeding was also financed from Singapore. Likewise, your engagement with the Heart of Borneo initiative and the conferences on the plight of the Sumatran rhino, and of course, Joseph Koh, Spider-Man, is there all the time. We have seen much during our visit for the past 2 days, and I must tell, NPARC is doing an excellent job. You may be small, but what you do is world class. I never thought that Singapore would be using its own native species to restore the forest and to make the environment even better. So, well done. Now, by coming to Sabah to explore our ecosites, you are indirectly helping to make conservation pay. So come in big numbers. We are also looking at the possibility of engaging into various MOUs with NPARCs, and I'm sure this will lead to better things. And for the Forestry Department, we will continue with our quest to achieve good forest governance and conservation. I've said enough, but if you're going to forget everything I just said, well, I hope you remember this. If the orangutan is to have the greatest chance of survival on planet Earth, it will have the greatest chance in Sabah, Malaysian Borneo, because in Sabah they are found mostly in totally protected areas or well-managed certified forests.